There at the roadside stood an oak tree. It must have been 10 times older than the birch trees that made up the wood, 10 times as thick and twice the height of any of them. That tree was enormous. It would have taken 2 men to join hands round its girth, with branches broken off it ages ago and its old cracked bark all scarred and broken. There it stood among the beaming birches, with its great gnarled hands and fingers, sprawling out awkwardly and unevenly, a truculent, sneering monster. He alone refused to submit to the charms of spring. He would not countenance either springtime or sunshine. Springtime, love and happiness, the tree seemed to be saying. Aren't you fed up with it all, this stupid, senseless sham? It never changes, the same old trick. There is no springtime, sunshine, or happiness. Just look at those dead fir trees sitting there, where they've been brought down. Always the same, every one of them. And look at me, sticking out broken, peeling fingers wherever they care to grow. Out of my back, out of my sides. That's how they've grown, and that's how I am. And I don't believe in any of your hopes and shams. Prince Andrei drove on through the forest, glancing back several times at the oak tree as if he was expecting it to do something. Flowers and grass grew underneath it, but it just stood there among them, an ugly, awkward thing, stock still and scowling. He's right, that tree. 1,000 times right, mused the prince. Other people, young people, they can keep that sham going. But he and I know what life is. Our lives are over and done with. The tree had stirred up a host of new ideas in the prince's soul, which held no hope, though their bitterness was sweet. On the journey there, he seemed to have reconsidered his entire life and come right back to his first conclusion, which was as reassuring as it was devoid of hope, that he needn't bother with anything new. All he had to do was live out his life without doing any harm, free from worry and any kind of desire.
Hello, listeners. This is Nick, and welcome to another episode of the Books of Some Substance podcast. Today, David, Nathan, and myself are continuing on our journey through Leo Tolstoy's War and Peace, this time tackling Volume 2. Take a read through and then listen in as we talk through love triangles, the nature of moral fiction, and reveal which of us most identifies with the character of Anatole. It's Nathan.
Should we do a recap of what happened?
Yeah, please.
Okay, let's do this. All right, so I took notes because I had no idea, trying to remember. And so here's the rough notes of some of the stuff that goes on. Okay, so we begin, we have the duel with Pierre and Dolokhov, right? After that, Liza, she dies in childbirth. Then, I forgot about this part, Dolokhov is turned down by Sonya, mm-hmm. right? So there's a lot of love triangles sort of going on earlier, right?
Also, I'm going to interject and just forget. I forgot how much Dolokhov was involved in so many things throughout. I just realized he's kind of in the mix a lot of the time.
He's a little instigator.
He's like a major minor character.
Sowing chaos in different people's lives throughout the story. Yeah.
Yeah.
Right. Which leads well into the next point, which is when Nikolai loses all of his gambling money to Dolokhov. Right,
otherwise known as Rostov throughout most of the book.
Yeah, it took me a while to put that together too.
Don't forget about our gentleman Denisov. Who, Natasha, Denisov?
Okay. I'm listening to the audiobook, so I'm going to correct your pronunciation and all the names throughout this.
This would be great. I'll love this. This works out well for being my kind of smart personality. So Denisov, forgot that Natasha turned him down.
Yeah, that was weird.
That happened
random.
Early on.
She was like 14 years old.
Yeah, jumping the gun there. And then we fast forward, we have Pierre, who gets into all the being a Freemason. And then he basically attempts to reform his land, free the serfs. He's all on this, do good kind of run. And then we have that whole episode where Denisov steals the supplies and he gets injured and he ends up in that horrible ass hospital.
Did he die?
And then...
What happened? I don't think he did.
Because later we find out that Rostov takes over essentially what he commanded.
Well, Denisov never got out of prison because Nikolai tried to take the petition to the emperor and got rejected.
Yeah, but we don't know what happened after that. We assume he went to prison?
I mean, I assume he just stayed in prison.
But he was in a hospital, not a prison, before.
Well, he was just being held in the hospital.
And until the court... trial or like the court martial?
Until the court martial, yeah.
Anyway, fuck
and
it.
Then I don't.
Sorry.
Yeah,
sorry.
I don't know. I was kind of surprised that that storyline was dropped too, because Denisov was kind of a major character for a minute.
I mean, welcome to like the whole how does Tolstoy write this book, and it's less of a plot line and more of just this kaleidoscope of check out this social interaction web that I'm drawing, that sometimes people are important and then other times people are less important.
Like life.
And yeah, exactly. Right. Like, you don't know if you're the main character. You're probably not. I'm a minor character for fucking sure. So where were we? Andre and Natasha, right? Get into that. So there's kind of that love thing.
Well, Andre returned. That was a big moment, right? Liza died, or did you say that? Liza dies in childbirth as Andre reemerges from the edge
yes.
of death.
I guess I forgot that. I forgot that volume one ended with Andre being dead.
Yeah.
So yes, it was actually an important thing that
major plot
that
point.
Andre was not dead. Okay. We're doing great at this, by the way.
Yeah.
Okay.
This is keep going real smooth.
So there's that. There's that nice Andre and Natasha thing. There's a whole thing where Andre sees the oak tree and he's all down on himself and he's like, everything is nothing. And then he falls in love with Natasha and he like sees the same oak tree and it's like, oh, check out that oak tree. Everything is burgeoning and there's life, right? So that was cool. Andre gets into politics and he's kind of like a dick. There's that whole speech about him being so logical and two men getting together, you know, in only the way that like two overcompensating men who think that they're so smart and they look down upon everyone else.
So like this podcast?
No, exactly. Because
I was like, Speransky? Is that?
Yeah.
All right, Nathan, just pronounce everybody's name correctly. Dick.
Yeah. Yeah. Way to show off. Well, because up until that point, I was like, I'm Andre. This is me. Look at how practical this guy is. Yeah. This is great. He's cold on the inside. But then, like, you know, got into that whole Speransky stuff where they were both assholes. From there, Pierre continues his whimsical journeys of the mind and realized that Freemasonry is empty. And then he gets back with his wife, Boris and Natasha. That was kind of a thing, remember? There was like on the cusp, and then he's sent away by her mom.
I don't remember that at all.
Yeah, he was kind of just like hanging around, and the Countess is like, this isn't going to happen. You need to get out of here.
So Boris's mother was like, get out of here?
No, Natasha's mother.
Wait, what? Wait.
Right? Wasn't Natasha's mom sent away?
Well, it would make more sense, I don't know.
I think so.
I guess they're both looking for a good marriage. But Boris's mother...
No, Boris's mother was the one who's like the bootstrapping one.
Yeah.
Who's like, you know, you got to get it all.
She's the one that soiree at the beginning of the novel. Like she's always hobnobbing and...
Wait, she's not the one who held the soiree at the beginning, is she?
Yeah, she is. She's Anna Mikko...
No, she didn't hold...
I don't know what her name is.
She didn't hold the soiree. She was at the soiree and then made the connections to get Boris the spot. This is great. We're doing great, guys.
Okay. Jesus.
It's like we've mostly read this book. I do think it was Natasha's mom that sent him away. That was basically like, you can't hang around here. This is a marketable woman. Like, you got to get out of here. Like, you're not going to marry her. Move on.
Anna Mikhailovna.
Right?
Anna Mikhailovna. I love saying that name because it's like all one big word. Anna Mikhailovna.
Because it's like another name that you knew how to pronounce from the audiobook.
Yeah.
All right, moving on. We get to the grand ball. Right, where Natasha and Andre, they dance, and then they get that year-long engagement thing going because the marriage isn't approved, and then Andre also has like a war wound that needs to be sent away in order for that to heal.
Nothing remember traveling like Europe to heal your wounds. What?
Yeah, exactly. Like also, you have to get somewhere where like the humidity's better, I think.
I didn't realize it in your edition of the book, does it have like the years marked on the chapters or the parts or something? Because this suddenly, right where we are now, suddenly 4 years has elapsed, or 3 or 4 years have elapsed
from volume one to volume two.
It mentions it.
No, so volume two begins in 1805, but by part three we're in 1808.
Yeah, it jumps quite a bit. Yeah,
yeah, you're right, this is like a fast forward part for sure.
Yeah, I just didn't realize that until later, and I was like, how old is Natasha now? Now she's marriageable, I guess?
Now she's 16. And she's 16 because the beginning she was like a child, and now everyone's like, look, it's not a child, even though it's still kind of a child. But I don't know, 200 years ago, I'm not going to be the person to comment on that. Okay, so we have that like super long hunting scene with uncle in parentheses.
That was awful.
I loved when they went to uncle's house and like just hung out with all the furs and he played the guitar and they danced. I thought that was fun.
Seemed great.
Oh, the weird semi-holiday where like the house serfs get into weird outfits and everybody's all dressed up and that one?
Yeah. Well, that happened directly after they went to uncle's.
Okay.
I think they went to like uncle's. Russian Burning Man. Nikolai and Sonia get together. So maybe some of this gets edited. This is great. This is good content.
This is solid.
So continuing on, Nikolai and Sonia get together. It's kind of forbidden a little bit, but it's real. That's one of the like central tenets of this, of like arranged marriages for, you know, the benefit of the family versus, you know, following your true heart, right? So we get that theme going. In the arranged side of things, Boris and Julie get married. She's 27 and on the edge of being marriageable. So this is the tail end of it, right? And so Boris, being the opportunist, takes advantage of that. And then we get into the saucy stuff with Natasha and Anatole, the empty blockhead who's just like real pretty, basically trying to abduct her. And that ruse is stopped by, actually, who stopped? Is it Sonia? Does Sonia tell?
Sonia, I think, is the first one that finds the letter.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then they get Pierre to go over there and he threatens to smash his skull in and kicks him out of the city.
Yeah. He roughs him up, grabs his collar, says you can't show your face around these parts. Natasha poisons herself, but in like a half-ass way. And so she's saved with the antidote. And then at the end, I guess I don't know if you guys felt this, but there was sort of like, is Pierre into Natasha now?
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's totally. That sort of new love, but that was like pulling him out of his whole philosophical depth of being essentially just a man waiting around to die in his own corpulence. So yeah, that was the whole arc, and
it ends with the comet scorching the sky.
It ends with the comet, and I think the best paragraph of the book so far, ooh, in my opinion.
That's definitely one of them.
Let me see if I can get there.
Or maybe we should give Nick a break. David, you want to read that?
Sure, man.
Somebody else read it. I'm exhausted.
I even wrote, at least it ended well. That's my note.
All's well that ends well.
It was clear and frosty. A dark, starlit heaven looked down on the black roofs and the dirty, dusky streets. Only by looking up at the sky could Pierre distance himself from the disgusting squalor of all earthly things as compared with the heights to which his soul has now been taken. As he drove into the Arbat, a vast firmament of darkness and stars opened out before Pierre's eyes. And there in the middle, high above Prichesensky Boulevard, amidst a scattering of stars on every side but catching the eye through its closeness to the earth, its pure white light and the long uplift of its tail, shone the comet, the huge, brilliant comet of 1812, that popular harbinger of untold horrors and the end of the world. But this bright comet with its long, shiny tail held no fears for Pierre. Quite the reverse. Pierre's eyes glittered with tears of rapture as he gazed up at this radiant star, which must have traced its parabola through infinite space at speeds unimaginable, and now suddenly seemed to have picked its spot in the black sky and impaled itself like an arrow piercing the earth, and stuck there, with a strong upthrusting tail and its brilliant display of whiteness amidst the infinity of scintillating stars. This heavenly body seemed perfectly attuned to Pierre's newly melted heart as it gathered reassurance and blossomed into new life.
It's a good paragraph.
Yeah, it's pretty good. There are moments in this section that are quite beautiful. I think, Nick, you mentioned Andre's, when he first comes upon the old oak tree that refuses to obey spring, is pretty good. I'm kind of into Pierre's weird relationship with mysticism and fellowship of man through the not the Knights of Columbus, Freemasons.
Freemasons.
Yeah, sorry.
The Freemasons.
I almost said the Knights of Columbus.
The Knights of Columbus.
yeah, but I was not into this volume as much as I enjoyed the first volume, and I think a lot of it had to do with all the love triangle bullshit. other than like little insights into characters' psychological motivations, I just kept, I don't know, I got a little bored with it.
Mm-hmm. It's like all peace. It's like no war. I mean, so it's funny. So it's a good point. The philosophical and psychological insight into the characters, I'm pretty into the Andre versus Pierre dichotomy because they've kind of flip-flopped over the arc of this volume. And so it starts out and Andre is just this cold, I'm going to live in the woods, nothing matters. The best I can do with my life is to just make it through and not hurt someone. Mm. And Pierre's like, I'm going to change the world. Check this out, guys. And then it basically kind of reverses itself where like the quotes from Pierre towards the end about just how nothing matters, about he's just a man just waiting. Where is this quote? I have one of my favorites.
I think it's at the beginning of the last section of this volume.
Well, I feel like a lot of it in this section, in this volume, the characters kind of flip like from their moral position in volume one to volume two.
Yeah. And I think that's part of the benefit of this is that people really are in development and motion. But here's the paragraph I was looking for. This was Pierre, one among hundreds of retired gentlemen in waiting, peaceably living out their days in Moscow. What horror he would have felt if he had been told on his return from abroad 7 years ago that there was no point in searching or taxing his brains because the way forward was set for him, marked out in advance for all eternity. And it was no use fighting against it because he was bound to turn out exactly like every other man in his position. He wouldn't have believed it. Had he not put his heart and soul into so many things, setting up a republic in Russia, turning himself into another Napoleon, or a philosopher, or a master strategist capable of defeating Napoleon? Had he not considered it possible and highly desirable to work for the regeneration of sinful humanity and bring himself to the highest degree of perfection? Had he not gone about founding schools and hospitals and liberating his serfs? But instead of all that, here he was now, the wealthy husband of an unfaithful wife, a retired gentleman in waiting, fond of his food and drink, not averse to unbuttoning his waistcoat after dinner and indulging in a little mild criticism of the government, a member of the Moscow English Club, and everyone's favorite on the Moscow circuit. It took him a long time to become reconciled to the idea that he was the very model of a retired Moscow gentleman in waiting, a type he had found so profoundly repellent 7 years ago. I'm into that arc.
That whole section and just the next page, near the bottom of 591, he had the unfortunate capacity that many men have, especially yeah. Russians, for seeing and believing in the possibility of goodness and truth, yet seeing the evil and falsehood in life too clearly to be capable of taking any serious part in it. Every aspect of human activity he saw is bound up with evil and deception. Whatever he tried to be, whatever he decided to do, he found himself repelled by evil and falsehood, with every avenue of activity blocked off. And meanwhile, he had to live on and find things to do. It was too horrible to be ground down by life's insoluble problems. So he latched onto any old distraction that came along, just to get them out of his mind. He tried all kinds of society, drank a lot, bought pictures, built things, and most of all, he read. And it kind of goes on, but I think a lot of this section with Andre and him, and even with other characters, it's all about, like, finding ways to distract themselves from life's misery. There's a lot of ideas in here about, like, submitting to something. With Pierre, he submits to this idea of religion, and, like, during his ceremony, it's all about, like, giving yourself over to something larger than yourself. And with, I think it might be Nikolai... Maybe, yeah, it's Rostov. When he talks about how when he returns to the military, it's so good to put life's bullshit behind and just become part of something else. I don't know if you remember that. And how much he really did not want to return back home.
I like that bit about the military. He described it as like an acceptable way to do nothing.
Yeah.
Yeah. The only time you're allowed to be idle.
Yeah.
So it's funny. There's like a breaking point. Because remember, Pierre goes through and he does that big speech to the Freemasons and then he's accused of, taking it in one direction versus the other.
Illuminism,
right? But there's a sentence at the end of that section that to me just fits so well with the present time, which is, for the first time in his life, Pierre was struck by the endless variety of men's minds, which guarantees that no truth is ever seen the same way between any two persons. Yeah. And that's like, we're fucking broken now. Like, we all have the exact same data and nobody can see anything similar. And like, when you really look that truth in the face, it can break you. where you're like, what's the point? What's the point of trying to be objective or trying to be right or wrong or something if people are just going to find whatever they want in it? And that was kind of, to me, like his downward slope coming out of that. And I was like, I get that. I hear you, man.
It's interesting that in the first half of the, or in the first volume of the book, you know, we get to see these different people and how they put the pieces together, how they value things, who they submit to. And then in the second volume, it's kind of, they're flipping on like Pierre, Andre, Nikolai, everybody's kind of going through disillusionment, finding something new. And at the end of this volume, it's kind of similar to the end of volume one, which is that amidst all this turmoil on earth, a character looks up at the sky and has this sort of sublime understanding that isn't capable of putting it into words.
Mm. Mm-hmm. Yeah. The same thing happened, I think we mentioned it, in volume one during war. At two different points, two different soldiers have this experience of near death and chaos, and they look up and like just observe nature for a moment and feel this mm-hmm. bizarre tranquility and release.
I think that fits into your sort of point about submission and stuff like that, which is essentially, to me, the questions in this book are really, you know, it's free will versus destiny, right? Do we have any agency? And we talked a little bit about that in volume one with the chaos of the military stuff and the battles and all that. But here you see characters in their own social nets essentially struggling against this, and whether you choose to marry for love or you choose to marry for social advancement, essentially the only thing that's consistent is this natural world. And by remembering that, like, you're a part of that, gives characters at multiple different points solace. And that's sort of the true, like, mystical content of this, in a way. Mm-hmm. It's that we're all part of nature, right? And that all of these other things are structures that are kind of, you know, they're created by society, but they're also kind of have predetermined our arcs. And so I thought that was, I don't know, that was an impressive theme to sort of I guess we're only halfway through, but sort of recycle and modify from applying to that in the military setting, which was kind of a major focus in volume one, to the social settings that is the major focus in volume two.
So I think all three of us kind of didn't like this volume as much as the first volume.
I liked it more. I'm gonna be the opposite force here.
In
I'll play this role. I got it.
I mean, I like development of certain characters, and parts of it I think are amazing. Just the first volume, once I got going with it, I was all in and just like was really enjoying it. And this, there were moments where I'm like, all right, let's pick it up. Come on. There were sections that just did not pull me in and keep me wanting to read. That's all.
Yeah, this is definitely like a very maximalist, realist approach to storytelling, right? It's not tailored down to the stuff that matters. And I think that's just going to be a reality with this book, is that it is like life, right? Who's a major character? Who's a minor character? I don't know. Stuff changes. Stuff fades in and out. But to me, it's just so much easier once you're invested in the characters that I know who they are, right? I don't have to be flipping back to page 1392 mm-hmm. in this lovely version that tells me the character list. But like, it's just, it feels like a natural progression. And I see the movement in Natasha, right? As essentially a child into a young woman. And I see the movement in Andre, and I see the movement in Pierre. And like, these things to me are just fundamental truths. Right? Like, just as cheesy as it sounds, like following your heart versus what you're told to do. I mean, is there any like more fundamental, like a human struggle than that? Like doing what you want versus doing like what you gotta do. I mean, that's my day-to-day like mental battle. And these characters, it's playing out. And based on how much they're playing the social game, their trajectory in society is dependent upon that. And so it's, I don't know. I just find like a huge amount of resonance. And so this to me had more momentum than some of the military heavy stuff in the first volume, which I liked, but I don't know, maybe I'm not like a historical buff. I'm more of like a show me the human traits kind of person.
I felt like in this, and maybe we'll kind of come through this because he's surprised me with character development so far. But I thought that in the first half or in the first volume, there just seemed like so much empathy for all of the characters, whether or not they seemed like they were good or bad. And in the second volume, I felt like it's kind of becoming clear there are characters who are bad, and he kind of writes that in rather than letting you come to your conclusions about Anatole and Alen, especially. And Dolokhov is an interesting character, I think. Actually, I'm interested in where Dolokhov goes, but especially what are their name? Anatole. I don't know their last names. Vasily. That whole family. They're kind of just...
Kurigan?
Karagin. Yeah. Like, especially Anatole. Like, he's, like, running over serfs, and he's just wicked through and through, which kind of seemed like a tonal shift to me that didn't seem as deep, but, you know.
I mean, that whole family was painted as pretty nasty in Volume 1. I mean, the father, Prince Vasily, is seen as, like, orchestrating this thing for his children to get ahead. Helene is never... She was never considered a... Or at least never written as a good character. Her entanglement with Pierre at the end of Volume 1 is seen as, like... I mean, at least in my perspective, I remember thinking, like, clearly, oh, that's not going to go well. This family is seen as kind of the most manipulative and don't have any real good intentions in them. At least it's never described as such.
No, I agree with you. That's how I read the first part. But the going from her being kind of selfish or shallow, I mean, she's not really characterized a whole lot.
Yeah.
Pierre, because she's obviously very popular and considered the height of fashion. But in Volume 2, she's like deliberately trying to destroy Natasha's life for no reason. For no reason. Just for fun.
Just looking for a good time.
Just for amusement. Which to me, that's like a different level. Like Vasily is trying, everybody's trying to manipulate the system so that they don't have to worry about money. They don't have to worry about their social position. And I don't think that that makes them evil. And I think that Tolstoy plays with that. Like, is Maria in a better position because she focuses on these missionaries who, in or these pilgrims who seem kind of silly also? Maybe she's deluded. Is Vasily and his family going to come out ahead because they know what's real? What's real is you have to have power and money. And that's an interesting thing to investigate. But once that family who's into power and money is like also into running over, murdering people, destroying people's lives for absolutely literally no reason.
Well, what else are you going to do once you have power and money except run people over and laugh at it?
Well, I mean, that's the moralizing. And I felt like Pierre has all the money in the world and he's not doing that, obviously. But he's also not, he hasn't clearly come out ahead in the story either.
So I guess I'm just not sure what your issue is, because I feel like those people exist. Like, there are people that are clearly like that.
Maybe. I mean, I think that there's just different ways to approach that, right? Like, Anatole, I feel like, is very clearly... I think Anatole could be an interesting character. He's somebody... And even Pierre looks at him and is like, oh, wouldn't it be nice to be like that? You just, like, roll with the punches, take what you can, and don't worry about anything. You can't control how somebody feels about you, so don't try to, you know, just take what you can and keep moving. And that's a very kind of like, you know, will to power, Nietzschean, Übermensch kind of way to go through life, right? And that's, everybody comes out ahead because everybody's acting selfishly, and you can do that without running over serfs and ruining people's lives. I'm just saying that I'm not, you know, Tolstoy wants to write it that way, whatever. I mean, certainly there are people like that, but I'm more interested in when the author allows you to empathize with somebody in a position that you wouldn't naturally see yourself in. And I felt that more in the first volume than the second volume.
So you're saying you're Team Anatole?
I'm Team Anatole.
Here's the deal. This guy's not all bad. All he did was try to abduct a young woman and take her into the wilderness with only like 20K in his pocket, and then she just poisoned herself. I mean, it's fine.
I think Volume 3 is going to be the redemption of Anatole and the fall of Pierre. How about that? On this note, are you guys getting any Game of Thrones crossover vibes here?
I can't even roll with that reference because
cool.
I actually don't know. I've read more Tolstoy than I have Game of Thrones.
Yeah, I don't remember enough. To be honest, I read like the first two books of that and maybe watched a season or two and then stopped.
Oh, come on. I know you're a super fan.
I mean, this is kind of a historical fantasy for sure. I mean, it's all power and the challenges associated with that. So my
It's like family struggles in the soap opera and family struggles set amidst war. But there's also two characters in Game of Thrones, Cersei and... I can't remember her brother's name, the Kingslayer, who are like major characters, brother and sister, have an incestuous relationship, also are all about power and manipulation of the system. They have like no, at least at the beginning of the series, they have no, seem to have no moral compass, which I was like, oh, that's kind of, that's a lot like Elen and Anatole. They're kind of, Elen at least is basically the queen of the book. She's at the center of fashion and society.
Isn't there also like a really long winter season in that book? And it's basically snowing in this book all the time.
So yeah, winter is coming. That's like,
there you go. There's your second. There's your, the settings are similar.
Yeah. I'm really looking forward to the zombies coming out in volume 3 of War and Peace.
We call them French.
Ah, yes. Taken after old man Bolkonski there. Bolkonski.
Bolkonski.
Yeah.
As he was calling out all the French spies sneaking in.
I'm really enjoying his arc of becoming a mad old bastard.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, I think at its core, Tolstoy books are not... So it's funny, we were having the Tolstoy versus Dostoevsky discussions last time. And I feel like this actually has some of the slightly more direct, heavy-handed, I'm going to tell you some philosophy right now, right? You get that in some of the sections with Andre and with Pierre. Yeah. But the third author that should always come up is Chekhov. And I was reading some Chekhov stories in between these volumes, and I realized that he's actually the one who does what you're looking for, Nathan, which is like basically rendering a character and letting you figure it out, the connection with it, and sympathizing. And Tolstoy tells you exactly what the character's doing and sort of how good or sort of how evil they are. In Dostoevsky, it's not even really about the character, it's just about the concept. Chekhov paints that picture. And so I think that's your prescription.
I got to pick up some Chekhov then. And I'll note, this is the first time I've ever read any Tolstoy. So I have absolutely no point of context. Other than the fucking 615 or 700 pages I've read so far.
It's all downhill from here.
Yeah.
I mean, I do think this is starting to show some of its flaws, which is just how gratuitous it can be at points. You know, like the hunting scene. Let's take the hunting scene.
Yeah, let's not take it.
Not. Yeah. let's just condense that one right there.
It's like a soap opera, right? You just tune in, see what happens in this episode. Nothing's going to get concluded, and then tune in next time. Also, yeah. Another tie-in to Game of Thrones. Game of Thrones is like a fantasy soap opera. So,
are you getting paid for that? Game of Thrones reference?
And this is unrelated, so sorry if I'm taking us on a tangent, but the idea of referencing a soap opera, like, it's something I understand, but I honestly don't think I've ever seen a soap opera. Like, have you ever watched one?
Like, I mean, I've seen it on TV. I don't think I've watched
so,
an
like,
episode.
This is
but
a,
I think I understand
the commonly held belief, and like people make this reference, and I've done it myself,
right?
But I've never actually seen one.
That's
I just have this funny idea. Oh, a soap opera has A, B, and C qualities. But I have no idea. I just assume that everybody is telling me the truth.
Now we apologize to the soap opera writers of the world that you have been grossly misrepresented, potentially, by many fans of literature.
Or maybe they did the job well. We haven't even seen it, and we know what they're writing.
Thing with soap operas that's just real impressive is that they filled all of that time. And I think, like, my guess is that there's sort of almost a mathematical approach to it. And you see some of that, again, this is third-hand knowledge because I haven't watched soap operas, so here we go. But you see that, like, recapping all of the love triangles at the beginning, and you remember that, you know, there was like a Natasha with Denisov, and then Natasha with Andre, and now we're talking Natasha with Anatole, and then coming back to Andre, but Andre is too stoic, right? Like that fits with, like, you know, as the world turns and stuff, like each like cliffhanger is just like a new permutation of the same like seven people that you have available. And like it's just,
so it's like high school.
It's content. It's like high school. I mean, if you want to follow a comparison, Nathan gets Game of Thrones, you get high school. I agree with both. But yeah, is this different than, like is the royalty in early 19th century Russia any different than senior year? Like, it kind of feels the same. It's very, a lot of infighting. There's the popular ones, the not so popular ones, the hanger-ons. We haven't talked about Berg and Vera. Is that right?
Oh, yeah. That, I loved that scene.
That section?
That
where they,
scene
where
was
they,
hilarious. Where, like,
yes, where they, had... they got everybody in. And it ended up being exactly the same as everything else, and they were, like, stoked about it.
And they were so stoked.
Because they recreated society in the way that they thought it should be. I mean, that was me in, like, 1999 when I was real embarrassed about everything. I just wanted it to be the same, man.
Just be the same. Just be like it's supposed to be. Yeah. But I love the scene where, like, so they had the apartment all set up, and then the first guest, I think Pierre shows up first, and everyone's standing there. Nobody knows what to do because nobody wants to move any of the furniture and disrupt how perfect the apartment is set up.
I mean, that's Tolstoy. Like, he was just calling out these stupid human behaviors that we do, and he was doing it in not even a mean way. He was just documenting it, and I just love that we're not any different. 200 years later, we're just exactly the same.
Can we pause and read a bit? I'm sorry, I'm having a really impossible time finding anything because 700 pages.
You got to keep a post-it note and just write down interesting things and page numbers.
Yeah, I did not. And I was switching back and forth between audiobook and this, so.
Like, page 432, dog on a fence!
I've got one for you. So here we go, in following a similar theme. Yes, Prince, you're quite right. In this day and age, Vera persisted. Talking of this day and age in the way that persons of limited intelligence generally love to do, all too certain that they have discovered and carefully considered what is special about their day and age, and that human characteristics change with the times. In this day and age, a girl has so much liberty that the pleasure of receiving a lot of attention often suppresses her true feelings. And it has to be said that Natasha is very vulnerable in that area. I mean, that's great. I love that. Like, I say sentences like that all the time when I want to be smart.
Yeah.
Like, well, the truth is, well, statistically speaking, oh, in this day and age, kids these days, you know, like, we're all just full of these same stupid social tics, and he recognized it. He just had a knack for writing those down.
There's a note on page 402, and it's about a character. I don't really know who he is. Some military character, Belibin, I think. Mm-hmm. And he's describing how he's like taking notes on different things that happened in the war. And I feel like this describes Tolstoy writing about these people. And it says he described the whole campaign with peculiarly. Oh man, I've never said that word out loud in my life. All right. So he described the whole campaign with peculiarly. I cannot say this word. All right. Someone go to page 402 and read that quote and tie it to Tolstoy's description. So anyway, peculiarly Russian objectivity, which means not without self-criticism and self-mockery. And I don't know why, but that made me think of how he's like approaching describing these people and these things. Just this, he's trying to be like objective, but
just
a little mocking.
Peculiarly.
Peculiarly.
There was one thing that was very peculiar about that. Yeah, thanks for jumping on those word pronunciations. You're the true hero.
That was English. That wasn't even Russian.
Yeah, I'm very tired.
What else we got?
So hold on, I got a question. I know later in life, Tolstoy became very obsessed with art being this vehicle for morality. Mm-hmm. And I think like kind of what Nathan was talking about, how he's describing certain characters, especially that one family, as being somewhat evil. I think you see in other characters a clear sense of duty and right and honor. And even though parts of like the Freemasonry section might feel preachy in the moment, he sort of undermines it later with Pierre's own falling in and out of this feeling. Do you ever feel like there's any sense of that Tolstoy is like pushing some sort of moral message, some sense of morality on the reader, on you?
I think what Nick was talking about, and maybe because of just what I've read about Tolstoy and what you're talking about, that he saw art as a path towards morality, and that was the role of art, that I'm maybe looking for that a little bit. But I feel like his approach is very humanist. It's like, understand this person deeply. And I think that's part of that morality. And I think the other thing is like nature. It's like all of this that's happening, you think this is everything. You think this is so important. And then you look up and you have a moment and you realize that none of this is important. None of this is permanent.
Yet you still have to behave in the right way to be a good person. It's not that it's not important.
Mm.
Because if it was truly not important, then what would it matter if you behaved well or not?
Well, I don't think that that's really settled. And that's why it kind of bothered me that the Anatole section got a little moralizing. Because like when he's talking about when Pierre has his religious epiphany and tries to free his serfs and make his
kind of fails.
Plantations more equitable. Well, he doesn't understand how to do that, right? And these reforms that he tried to make that he thought were successful were actually like making the serfs work harder because now they weren't able to work on Sundays. And because of this, then they had to do that. And the serfs' lives were actually not made any better, even though they were free now that they were more enslaved. And so it's like, yeah, you can try to do good. You can try to benefit people, but it's not always clear that you are. So
because he didn't understand the system and he didn't understand the people he was dealing with, whereas Andre, he understood it and he was able to free serfs and became well known for it.
Mm.
And he even kind of has to like somewhat lie about his motivations to appease, you know, the upper class people that he's talking with at one point. I don't know if you remember this, but not to go too far off into that, but I think you see in characters' actions a sense of right and wrong and what makes a person good. Or maybe I'm reading into that.
No, I think it's there.
At the same time, I feel like it seems to me that Pierre and Natasha are kind of our two primary central characters. And they're morally very wishy-washy. They're kind of riding the tide. But I get the feeling that we're supposed to empathize greatly with these characters. And they're written, especially Natasha's written, in spite of her flaws, as a very... All the characters love her. All the characters want the best for her, or except Anatole and Hélène, apparently, kind of in spite of everything. So I guess I would just say that it's not really clear to me by the characters' actions what good action means to Tolstoy. Well, I how would you know, right? Is it... Because, you know, kind of traditionally in a morality play, justice prevails. Character cheats, they get caught. If they persevere, they achieve some sort of liberation, whether materially or spiritually. And because we're in the middle of a tome, it's not clear who's going to achieve that at the end. Because characters who seem to be getting there in volume one, like to me, like Maria, who was kind of trying to be very spiritual and distance herself from the material world, is kind of in a mess now. And, you know, Nikolai, who put a lot of his faith in nationalism, is kind of a mess. Pierre is kind of a mess after like trying to have this religious convergence. Andre almost seems, every time he tries to get involved, like in the war, try to do something meaningful, gets the shaft, falls in love with Natasha. She's not faithful, steps back. And so he's kind of like trying to do good, but seems to keep getting pushed out. And to me is kind of fighting this. You know, his father kind of became the hermit also, and he's kind of trying not to be that hermit who just retreats from society.
I think you just answered the question right there. You get a sense of these characters trying to do good.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm.
It's the intention, it's the effort, it's the little actions that they do that show you that they're trying to be good people. And so, as readers, we sympathize with that and we follow them, whereas the characters that don't really have that, like Anatole, like Hélène, we don't get any sense that they're trying to do anything good other than wield power. Like, you get a hint of Dolokhov, like, as being, like, this good son and this good brother. And he has this little speech early on that, you know, talks about how people see him as this one thing, and he doesn't give a shit. As long as he protects his family and those he loves, then he's okay. And you get this sort of like, oh, okay, so maybe he's not that bad of a dude. But then he goes and screws his buddy at the time, Nikolai, out of an insane number of rubles.
Well, that was over Sonya.
Yeah, yeah.
Right. But I think we're kind of circling around this topic, but I think fundamentally it's hard not to read Tolstoy as a moral writer. I think that's in it. I mean, he drops nuggets like this that I highlight, and I'm like, yeah, this is great. Talking about Andre, says, he possessed in the highest degree the one quality that Pierre totally lacked, a practical application to get things going with no fuss or struggle. That's like some Protestant work ethic crap right there. And I think if you view this through the lens of religion, things like that, and you drop Christianity on top of it, you know, Christianity is kind of this bizarre balance between saying that as long as you believe in it, you're good. Like, we got you. We fundamentally have you covered. You can be the worst person, but as long as you believe and you repent, like, you're going to make it to heaven. But at the same time, there's also this moral and work ethic, and you must do these tasks, these correct things, that is preached throughout all of the flavors of Christianity. But at some level, there's also a limitation to what you can do yourself. So there's also the limitations mm-hmm. of that agency to be able to achieve a high level of morality. And so when I read all these things together, this does seem like, yes, it's trying to showcase in a moral sense what these characters are doing, what's right, what's wrong, and we definitely get clear flavors of that. But I think what's less clear and perhaps more of an intellectual exercise to ponder is where that fits in terms of, you know, free will versus destiny, or mapped onto Christianity, how much you're actually responsible for your own morality and salvation. And I think that's, honestly, it's the different blends of Christianity have kind of followed different balances of that. Some really emphasize the acts, and some are really, really heavy on emphasizing the redemption and the belief, right? And so there's just, yeah, that's bouncing around in there, I think.
I don't get a whole lot of sense of destiny playing a role so much as free will is a big part of this novel, and not only yours, but everybody else's, because other people's actions are going to cause you to react, and those reactions are going to snowball endlessly into other reactions. Like, there's just this web of people making choices and how it affects everybody else.
Can I read a quote to refute that?
Sure.
Every action they perform, which they take to be self-determined and independent, is in a historical sense quite the opposite. It is interconnected with the whole course of history and predetermined from eternity.
Where was this?
Yeah, where was that?
It drops in that section where essentially Nikolai goes back and he's trying to drop the Denisov letter, and he sort of witnesses how chummy everyone is. Remember that historical section?
Yeah.
Or mm-hmm. I say historical, that section of like the more history related things. I think it dropped in there. But I have the quote pulled out. So your guess is as good as mine.
Oh, damn. Because I wanted to know if that came in a specific thing, or if that's through somebody else's speech. Because I don't remember that seeing that. And I feel like that's so bizarre, because it feels so like the antithesis of what this novel is doing to me, anyway. That throws a wrench in my whole feeling of this book. Because it's true. I mean, they are characters, and Tolstoy is the one manipulating them as he sees fit. They are predetermined in that way. The perception of what Tolstoy is trying to do in terms of people in action, it seems the opposite of what he's trying to say about human interaction. Or maybe I'm wrong. Maybe this is a really long-winded way of 1,000 pages of saying, it doesn't matter. Whatever was going to happen was going to happen. But you just had to read it anyway?
I want to answer your part, but I can't yet.
Okay, that's all right. Nathan, do you have a dog in this fight?
Not really. But I think that it's somewhere in between that, like, he draws that contrast between all that's happening and all this fighting and all these manipulations and then, you know, the sky. And I feel like it's kind of the same thing. All these people striving, all these people trying to direct their path in the world. But it's not clear, you know, how much are they wound up clocks and how much are they determining that themselves. Like, everybody's caught up in machinery that's bigger than them, whether they're in the military or whether they're in society and trying to manipulate society. They didn't choose to be in that society, you know. And then, you know, somebody like Natasha, maybe, for instance, she's kind of maybe the real free spirit. She kind of does what she wants, and she tries to run off with Anatole for no good reason. And then, you know, society comes and clamps her down. So how free is she actually to do that?
I guess that was my original argument. Not that it's all about the choices people make and how they interact with other people's choices. But yeah, I'm in agreement with you. Other than like the society you're born into. I mean, essentially that is going to determine a great part of your life. But once you're there, I'm saying like once things are in motion, and maybe this is my own personal belief clouding my judgment, in terms of how I read the book, I don't see in this novel an idea other than the quote that Nick read, which does seem to refute my interpretation of how.
Which I have, tracked this back to being in volume 3, by the way.
Oh, you son of a bitch!
Oh, ruined it.
Oh, Nick. Oh, cheater.
The themes are totally different in volume 3.
Yeah. But that's when we find out that all of this was meaningless and it was all inevitable and going to happen anyway.
Yeah. Got real Calvinistic.
It's like a prelude, little foreshadowing of volume 3.
There we go.
And it's like, oh, shoot, that's volume 3. Tune in next time for more.
It's literally chapter 1 of part 1 in volume 3.
Well, spoiler.
Thanks for listening. You can find out more about us at booksofsomesubstance.com and on Instagram and Twitter with the handle booksosubstance. Keep on reading War and Peace and look for episodes on Volume 3 and Volume 4 to come out in May and June. And as always, if you can, click some buttons on the internet for reviews and likes and all that good stuff. Every little bit helps. Until next time, happy listening.
I really enjoyed the scene where Boris is trying to woo Julie and they're trying to like out melancholy each other and writing really sappy goth poetry.
Melancholy is the fashion.
Yeah.
Some things are evergreen, you know?
Julie was so sweet with Boris, sympathizing with his premature alienation from life, offering him what consolation she could as a good friend. She having suffered so much in her own life, and she opened up one of her albums for him. Boris drew a little sketch of two trees and wrote underneath, "Oh, rustic trees, your somber branches shed upon me darkness and melancholy." On another page, he did a drawing of a tomb and inscribed below it, "Our strength and stay is death. Death brings us peace tomorrow. Ah me, no other power can shelter us from sorrow." Julie thought this exquisite.
And then they put on the AFI record and made out.
I love it.